from the Jeannie Hayes Virtual Studio. This is Marquette Now.
Good evening and welcome to Marquette Now. I'm Isabel Tussle.
And I'm Kaylee Starrell. In some breaking news, head women's soccer coach Marcus Roeders is stepping down.
Sports reporter John Leuzzi is in the newsroom with the latest. John?
At 10:05 this morning, Marquette Athletics sent out a press release from Vice President and Director of Athletics, Bill Scholl, stating Marcus Roeders has stepped down at the helm of the women's soccer program after 24 years. In the press release, Scholl said the step down is effective immediately and went on to thank Roeders for what he has done, not just for the program, but for the university. Roeders' step down comes after two consecutive losing seasons for the Golden Eagles, his first of his career. In those two seasons, the Golden Eagles combined for 10-22-4 and only won 5 games in the Big East play, along with not making the playoffs for back-to-back seasons. Roeders is the longest tenured head coach of the Marquette women's soccer program and the third only coach in program history. He just fell short of 330 wins in his 24 years. Now, what we do know is that assistant coaches Ashley Bars and Nick Vorberg do remain on the coaching staff, according to athletic spokesman Mike Whitliff. Now, Scholl did went on finish his press release saying that Marquette will immediately start a nationwide search for their fourth coach in program history. Back to you guys in the studio.
Students are concerned with some recent robberies and crime on campus.
Sarah Lipo, executive news editor for the Marquette Tribune, joins us live from the scene of a recent robbery on 16th Street to talk about crime on campus.
I'm standing in the annex about a block away from where a recent phone robbery occurred on campus. When crime occurs on campus, a news reporter is sent to the scene immediately to get a first-hand account of what happened. Then, individuals are in the newsroom and call the Office of Marketing Communication and MUPD for more information. MUPD Assistant Chief Jeff Kranz said that when weapons are involved in calls on campus, all resources are sent to the scene. Lexi Padawadmi can tell us more about a recent robbery on campus.
Take a look down Wisconsin Avenue and you'll likely see students on their cell phones. They're texting, they're talking, they're listening to music. What they're not doing is paying attention.
I'd like to think that I'm like very aware of what's going on around me, but like sometimes, you know, you're listening to your music, you're on your phone, people are always on their phone.
Many students, like Jane Layden, mindlessly use their phones on the streets without even realizing the potential danger it brings.
I wasn't really even aware of this. And like, that is so frightening to me because I always feel safe like on Marquette's campus, honestly. I feel like I'm walking alone more than I maybe should be now that I know this.
According to the Federal Communications Commission, 1 in 3 robberies nationwide now involves taking a phone. Student Charlie Angevine was recently added to that statistic after his cell phone was stolen near 16th and Wells.
I was next to the car and he took the phone and the phone's mine. And my brain was just like, that's not his phone, that's yours. Grab on the car, he'll give it back. It didn't work, but that was, I guess, what I thought.
Marquette Campus Safety advises students to keep phones and personal items stowed away and to give up your property if ever approached.
I'm going to walk home with it in my pocket, if anything, and like guard it. So, yeah, definitely. Yeah, it's a little freaky.
I'm Lexi Poitamani, Marquette Now.
Back to you, Kaylee and Isabel.
Joshua Riccio, the Marquette student charged with a misdemeanor last week, is pleading not guilty. Riccio appeared in court yesterday for his hearing. Riccio, a sophomore in the College of Education, allegedly posted a video on Snapchat showing another student handling rifle magazines. The caption for the video was, "Don't go to school today." Riccio will appear again in court on December 5th. Marquette Now is following the story, and there will be more details to come.
Marquette is celebrating first-generation students on campus. The official celebration is Friday, but Marquette is hosting a series of events tomorrow in the library and the AMU. Events include a FAFSA Q&A, a graduate school information session, trivia with the provost, and a craft activity in the evening.
Marquette is releasing results from an anonymous engagement survey taken by employees. It highlights strengths and opportunities that can develop job satisfaction. Over 1,000 employees took the survey, representing 30% of faculty and over 50% of the staff and administration population. The survey found that over 70% of employees are satisfied with Marquette, while 20% are dissatisfied. About 80% of employees are satisfied with their supervisor or boss, while 15% are dissatisfied.
Marquette is promoting its graduate school to prospective students. The graduate school will host an open house on Thursday, November 7th from 5 p.m. to 7 p.m. in the AMU Monahan Ballroom. The event is open to anyone interested in pursuing a graduate degree. Attendees will be able to meet professors, faculty, and current students. Marquette talks about how it strives to be the difference.
But being the difference includes a lot of the work the university does. Amanda Parrish shows us exactly why Marquette earns the award of Employee of the Year.
With a life unfamiliar to many, sometimes you have to be a little creative. With his job coach, Dwight Johnson, Ivan Lopez adjusts his janitorial role at Marquette's Recreation Center to work with his wheelchair and cerebral palsy.
You remember your first day working here? How hard it was? Is your job done got a lot easier for you now?
Yeah. Lopez and Johnson have been working together since Lopez's senior year of high school 6 years ago. Director of Recreational Sports, John Sweeney, was a part of hiring Lopez, along with creative employment opportunities.
I immediately said yes, and it was just a matter of figuring out, okay, what kind of job duties would work out for both us and that Ivan would be capable of doing.
Efforts towards inclusivity like this helped Marquette win CEO's 2019 Employer of the Year Award last month. But this award is much more than a plaque.
And to see how they are really part of society, what can we do to help make them even more part of a society and to have more of appreciation and a sensitivity toward working with those individuals.
According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, the employment rate of those with a disability is 8%, more than double the rate of those without disability. While there are still a ways to go to create a community of inclusivity, Lopez and Johnson are happy to grow up Marquette.
You're a pretty good job coach or a bad job coach?
In the Recreation Center, I'm Amanda Parrish, Marquette Wire News.
Stay tuned after the break to talk about some of the crazy snow we've been having lately.
And of course, we have lots of important events happening around campus.
This is the story of a boy who is very sensitive to lights and sounds. So he built secret hiding places where nothing could get in. The boy didn't like looking people in the eye. It made him feel uncomfortable. One day, he found out he had something called autism. His family got him help. And slowly, he learned how to live with it better.
Early intervention can make a lifetime of difference. Learn the signs at autismspeaks.org.
Touchdown! Oh. Did you see that?
Whoa, we scored?
Yeah, we scored. We're going to the playoffs.
I can't believe I missed that. Every time I'm buzzed, I spend too much time on my phone.
What? I should take your phone away.
No. I'll call for a ride. Hey, why does my face look like that?
I'm playing with these new face filters.
Okay, you know what?
Yep, that's mine.
I'm gonna need that back.
Nope.
Kevin!
So, I just moved in with this family, and it's embarrassing. The little one, he likes to go outside and crawl around in the giant litter box. I don't know what he's doing. I mean, I was born, and I knew how to use the litter box. Look at that! That's disgusting! Oh, poop already! You're making me nervous. Okay, I can't look at this anymore. I really hope he grows out of this, for his sake.
Hello again, and welcome to Marquette Now. I'm Isabel Tussle.
And I'm Kaylee Starrell. The holidays are an important time for Marquette's campus.
As Isabella Lazarski discovered, the Office of Residence Life put on some special events in honor of Halloween this past week.
as cooler weather sets in and spirits are high.
Rub my face.
Milwaukee locals are quick to embrace the Halloween festivities. This October 30th, Marquette University's Office of Residence Life is hosting their annual Halloween. Luis Navarrete is the co-chair coordinator of the Halloween event and gives more details on how the night is planned.
Kids from all over the Milwaukee area who live in not-so-safe neighborhoods that come down and trick-or-treat. They go through all the halls. They have, you know, their costumes on, and they all walk through the halls, knock on dorms, and trick-or-treat for candy.
Children are also able to get creative in the crafting boutique room and participate in the carnival, located in the basement of the Alumni Union. Marquette student volunteer John Madigan,
almost a strike. One more shot, man.
Explains why he's been coming back to help year after year.
I loved it so much. I couldn't even begin to talk about how much fun it was last year. My favorite time of the year, honestly, though.
Though the Halloween season is over.
Oh, bank shot. Yeah.
Kids in the Milwaukee area can look forward to more events to come from Marquette's Office of Residence Life. In Milwaukee, I'm Isabella Lazarski, Marquette Wire News.
The College of Nursing is hosting a healthcare talk next week. On November 14th, you can go to Looking to 2020 Healthcare and Politics. It'll discuss the role that healthcare policy has in the 2020 election and the attitudes that Wisconsin voters have about it. Some of the panelists include healthcare professionals, along with the director of the Marquette Law School poll, Dr. Charles Franklin. It will be held at the Wisconsin Club from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m.
Marquette is focusing on its social justice initiatives. Marquette will co-host Art Activated, the inaugural Social Justice Summit from No Studios. The event will take place November 15th through 16th, with the second day of the event taking place at the AMU.
Looking to get into 3D modeling? Rainer Memorial Libraries is hosting a 3D modeling workshop this Sunday at 12:30 p.m. in the Digital Scholarship Lab. You can learn how to create and print 3D drawings using the library's 3D printers. Attendees will gain a basic understanding of 3D modeling and can make their own 3D printed design.
Every student likes two things, food and money. Marquette's Dining Services is providing both of those things for those in the Marquette community. Students that complete the Customer Loyalty Online Survey will be eligible to win a few prizes. Prizes include a $25 brew gift card or an Herbert and Gerbert's party platter. Wisconsin is known for its crazy weather.
But with recent snowfalls, many students have been wondering how and why it's been snowing so early in Milwaukee. Natalie St. Ange investigated these peculiar weather patterns.
With falling leaves and crisp autumn air, the weather had some special tricks and treats this Halloween for some parts of Wisconsin.
Last Thursday, Milwaukee was one of many places that received record-breaking snowfall across Wisconsin, making it one of the spookiest Halloweens yet. Lecturer meteorologist Paul Joseph says he's never seen anything like it.
The snow we had last week, especially on Thursday, was quite a bit. I mean, October, you normally don't see any snow at all.
Joseph was a meteorologist at WTMJ4 in Milwaukee for 36 years. He's from Arizona originally and loves how Wisconsin in particular has drastic weather changes.
I think with the snow we had last Thursday and a couple few tenths of an inch before that, we ended up with just a hair over 6 inches for the month. I think we were 2/10 of an inch under the all-time record snowfall for the month of October.
Joseph has been teaching an intro to meteorology class at Marquette University since 1988. And while Joseph told people on air for 36 years to be cautious and safe on slippery roads, he wants everyone to remember one thing.
One of the toughest types of weather to forecast is how much snow are we going to get?
Reporting from Milwaukee, I'm Natalie St. Ange, Marquette Wire News.
Can you believe that it snowed on Halloween this year?
I know, right? Kate Highland, can you tell us more about this crazy weather we've been having?
Yes, I'd love to. So first, let's take a look at what the weather is looking like right now outside in Milwaukee. So we've got our weather advisory. Right now, we're sitting at 33 degrees Fahrenheit. We've got humidity of 75%, precipitation at 50%, and then some winds coming from the north at 10 miles per hour. So now looking at the overview, state of Wisconsin, way up north in Superior, we're looking at 16 degrees. Coming down, we've got Green Bay is at 21 degrees, and then finally right here in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, we've got 23 degrees. A little warmer than those. Looking at tomorrow's highs up in Superior, we've got 27 degrees. Then at Green Bay, getting a little bit warmer at 31 degrees. And then finally, it's the same for us, 31 degrees tomorrow in Milwaukee. So tonight, we've got 23 degrees, humidity at 68%, precipitation at 40%, then the winds coming from the northwest from 10 to 15 miles per hour. And then tomorrow we've got 31 degrees, so getting a little bit warmer with humidity at 54%, precipitation at 0%, thank goodness, and then our winds northwest 10 to 20 degrees. So looking at our 5-day forecast, Friday we've got some clouds with the sun trying to get through, then unfortunately for the weekend we've got some cloudy weather, but look into next week, hopefully we can get a little bit more sun in. And looks like Friday and Saturday we've got a little higher, 32 degrees and 40 degrees. So that's it for weather. Stay tuned for sports. Action.
Gotcha! I surrender!
All right, pal. Get ready for the day, buddy.
Hey, Dad. Do we have a gun?
What's up?
Do we have a gun?
There are amazing things to discover in the forest.
Toothless, time to go.
What you picking up on, bud?
It's a whole hidden world of wonders and the perfect place to spend time with family. What better place to let your imagination soar? Experience nature and create a memory you can share. Visit discovertheforest.org to find a forest or park near you.
Sometimes the things we do or say can make others feel hurt, excluded, or isolated. Everything you say and do creates an impact.
How am I supposed to save the whole world?
You can't think about saving the world. You have to think about saving one person.
Because of you, someone's entire life can change. You don't have to be a superhero to have a positive impact.
Friends?
Friends.
Back to Marquette Now. I'm Jackson Gross with your Marquette Sports Update. Like John Liuzzi discussed at the beginning of the show, women's head coach of soccer Marcus Reuter stepped down just this morning. He was the head coach for the team for 24 years. Reuter is the third Marquette women's soccer coach in Marquette history. This was his first head coaching job. But before the news was announced, the women's soccer team had been pushing along this past week. The team recently was eliminated from postseason play for the second straight season as the Golden Eagles fell to the Paul Blue Demons 4-0 Friday afternoon after the game was canceled the day before due to snow. Switching over to men's soccer, the team captured a 1-0 win this afternoon against the Paul Blue Demons. Sophomore striker Lucas Sunesson scored the golden goal for the Golden Eagles in the 62nd minute. The team awaits their postseason status as Villanova actually defeated Seton Hall tonight, and they will play Providence at Providence this Saturday at 11 a.m. Historic wins for both basketball programs yesterday as Marcus Howard became the men's basketball's all-time leading scorer in Marquette's 88-53 victory over Loyola Maryland. Jack Phillips recaps the action from Pfizer Forum.
With number 12, Cam Spencer.
New numbers means new faces. But on Tuesday night, the story stays the same for Marquette men's basketball. More specifically, the AP All-American himself.
Guys like Greg and Zach were telling me, you know, hey, like, you're getting close, so
like, keep shooting. So when your teammates have that much confidence in you, it just makes things so much easier for you. So I was playing pretty free out there just because my teammates were believing me that much.
38. No, I'm not talking about the temperature outside. I'm talking about Marcus Howard's 38 points to start off his senior season right here in Fiserv Forum.
Yeah, I'm not sure I've seen anyone that can be a one-man wrecking crew like he can offensively, because you know his ability to make difficult shots is beyond what I've ever seen.
In a complete team effort, the Golden Eagles start their 2020 season off with an emphatic win over the Loyola Maryland Greyhounds. Howard may still be the star of the show, but it's not just the offense that's clicking. After Theo John dishes out a career-high 8 blocks, it resonates throughout the entire squad. Don't believe me? Just ask Marcus himself.
There's no doubt about it in my mind. He's the best rim protector in the country. I mean, the way he is able to get off the floor and protect our paint, block shots, you know, disrupt the defense with his verticality and his aggressiveness. I don't think there's anybody in the country that can do it like he does. And, you know, I'm glad he's on our team and I'm not playing against him.
Reporting alongside Amy Galashevsky from Fiserv Forum, Jack Phillips, Marquette Wire Sports.
Meanwhile, Megan Duffy recorded her first official win as head women's basketball coach, defeating Morgan State 7-48 Tuesday morning. Amy Galashevsky reports from the Al McGuire Center.
It wasn't what you would expect for an early Tuesday morning game. Children from Milwaukee Public Schools were there for their annual field trip day. The energy level was through the roof because the kids had the morning off from school, and they were excited to cheer on Marquette in their first regular season game of the year. Despite getting off to a slow start, the Golden Eagles earned themselves a 70-48 victory over the Morgan State Bears. Marquette finished the first quarter tied 13-13, but then they finally found their composure in the second quarter.
Well, first we had to get stops, and then Chloe's rebound. She had like 8 defensive rebounds, and then Jordan just getting out in transition, pitching it ahead, and then wide open shots.
In the third quarter, the kids were sure to showcase all their dance moves and increase their volume. However, Marquette's offense was quiet. This was until junior Selena Lott went off and earned herself 24 points.
And she just was poised, composed. Obviously, she's played in a lot of big games here at Marquette, and that showed, whether she was playing the point, whether she was off the ball, super engaged with the game plan and kind of what we were trying to do. And I just think she's contagious in so many ways on the defensive end, and then she starts hitting a couple shots. I think it really kind of spurred our team in a lot of ways.
The Golden Eagles will be back in action this Thursday against St. Francis College Brooklyn. Reporting from the Al McGuire Center, Amy Galashevsky, Marquette Wire Sports.
Taking a look at Marquette volleyball, the team remains at number 10 in the AVCA coaches poll after sweeping Xavier at home Friday and Butler in Indianapolis on Sunday. Head coach Ryan Tice's squad is 21-3 and 11-1 in Big East play. The team hosts DePaul Friday at 7 p.m. and then will go down I-94 to take on the Blue Demons in Chicago Saturday at 6 p.m. Well, that's all I have for sports. Don't go anywhere because Annie Matei will be right back with Down to the Wire.
Operation Wonder Park is a go!
There's nothing more powerful than imagination.
Honey, have you seen my cell phone?
But don't just imagine.
My park came to life?
Ooh, a plot twist!
Use STEM to build.
Ta-da!
Create.
She did it!
And change the world.
Who's with me?
I'm more of a 2 feet on the ground kind of guy.
Hurt tomorrow.
If she can STEM, so can you. Find out more at She Can STEM.
There was an old woman who lived in a shoe. She had so many children, she didn't know what to do. She gave them some broth without any bread and kissed them all soundly.
Lights out.
Good night.
And put them to bed. Hunger is a story we can end. End it at feedingamerica.org.
Awkward.
I'm the awkward silence.
You try to avoid me, then there I am again.
But an awkward silence can be a great thing.
Like Kelly here is about to demonstrate.
You haven't really been yourself lately. Are you okay?
Find out how you can help a friend with their mental health at seizetheawkward.org.
We have an exciting new projects piece on the Democratic National Convention coming to Milwaukee.
Annie Mattee joins us live in the newsroom with Grace Dawson for more. Annie?
Welcome to this week's edition of Down to the Wire. I'm here with Grace Dawson to talk about her recent projects piece that tells us a little bit more about the DNC coming next summer. How are you, Grace?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm great. So tell me how Milwaukee is preparing for the DNC.
So Milwaukee is preparing for the DNC in a number of ways. First, the local host committee is working on organizing its various teams and departments, which will be organizing the convention and making sure that it all runs smoothly. They are also working on the delegate accommodations for the event. The Milwaukee Police Department is also working preparing for the convention. They've been meeting with outside security groups such as the Secret Service to work in establishing the security perimeter and also to make sure the logistics for the event run smoothly.
So what will be some of the economic impacts from the DNC?
So there's a projected economic impact of $200 million, which will reach local businesses who will see experienced revenue during the event, as well as hotels reaching as far as Madison and other organizations in town.
So how can Marquette students get involved with the DNC?
So there will be a number of ways for Marquette students to get involved during the convention. There are a number of internship opportunities that students can apply to, which can be found on Handshake, as well as different classes focusing on the DNC and internships. For example, the political science internship course is being offered during the summer for students who want to receive credit in that. In order to accommodate the DNC, instructors will have to reshape their courses, either using the Summer 51 session, which will start 1 week earlier than the Summer 2 session, which will allow the classes during the DNC to be canceled.
Are the Marquette College Democrats or College Republicans getting involved?
So the College Democrats have not planned any events yet. However, they are meeting with their executive board is meeting with different people involved in the event. The College Republicans have not planned any events, but they are happy about the commerce and tourism being brought to the city.
Who is expected to come to Milwaukee for the DNC?
So there's a projected 50,000 visitors, which includes about 6,000 delegates, 15,000 national and international press corps members, and about 30,000 other enthusiasts, including people from different nonprofits, corporations, politicians, and just general political enthusiasts.
How does the Milwaukee DNC preparation differ from DNCs of the past?
So this host committee has doubled the size of the Philadelphia host committee, which allows them to establish more departments and reach more areas. For example, they have a department focused on supplier diversity and intentional inclusion, which is making sure that the economic impact from the convention reaches everyone in the city.
So I know that some people have been mentioning a contested convention. Can you mention a little bit about that?
Yeah, so a contested convention would be if there were multiple rounds of voting to confirm the nominee as opposed to just one. If this did occur, it would be the first one since 1952, bringing even more press to the city, as would be a historic event.
That's all we have time for. Thank you so much for being here, Grace. Back to you, Kaylee and Isabel.
Once again, I'm Isabel Tussle.
And I'm Kaylee Starrell. Good night, Marquette.
Home fire drills give your family a plan of action. In a home fire, you may have less than 2 minutes to get out. So when you drill, show everyone two ways out of the house, pick a safe meeting spot, and get there in under 2 minutes. Then practice home fire drills at least twice a year. You can even make them fun. So everyone knows the sound and exactly what to do when they hear a smoke alarm. Go to ready.gov/firedrill and learn how to prepare your family for home fires.
Look at you. You're at the top of your game. You're unstoppable. Nothing can throw you off track. Wait, is that your car? Uh-oh. Yeah, I saw that coming. That will throw you off track. You're looking at around 10 grand in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. Let's try this again. Smart move. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.